everyone. How y'all doing tonight? Let me pull up my notes. Oh, yeah. Okay, they're going to play my reel first.
Give me that back. You know I make it, take it, make it, take it. Give me that back. No, I'ma make it, take it, girl. Give me that back. You know I make it, take it, make it, take it. Give me that back. No, I'ma make it, take it, girl. I'm so direct, next level, yeah, you're cool, but my shit better. Load your gun, been trying to tell you, y'all Emma can kill this rebel. She said, I bow you over, he said, it's cool, now girl, roll over. Take it like a man, stand like a soldier, boys make noise, I'm taking over. I know you want it, these girls are on it. I just can shake it, we created, you can take it. These girls are heated, they stay defeated. She can take the beat and keep on screaming, we can hear it. Bitches wicked, cheap trick lies, don't know I'm listening. These girls cry cause they can't get it. Never on the hits cause she turned flicked. Who wants to be my partner? They jump first but we jump harder. Think don't blink, who's staring longer? Take it there, we take it farther. I know you want it, these girls are on it. I just can shake it, we create it, you can take it. These girls are heated, they stay defeated. She can take the beat and keep on screaming, we can hear it.
Just gonna be where it's gonna be. All right. My name is Penelope Niederlander. I've been working in the field of motion graphics and VFX and digital art in general for about 16 years. I spent 10 years freelancing and doing my own jobs in Los Angeles, and then I've been in Austin for the last six. I've taken a departure recently and took up a job at Rooster Teeth, where I am the lead compositor on a show that we produce called Ruby. Has anyone heard of Ruby? Oh, snap. Okay, cool. Ruby is a American-made anime. It's done entirely in 3D. We have a 3D pipeline, but we finish in After Effects. And it's a really fun show. I would check it out. This season is pretty cool. Also, I have to do this because my producer let me come and do this. If there's any lighting artists or compositors that are looking to get into the field of compositing on one of our anime shows, please come see me. So, what I'm going to demo today is a little different than demos you might have seen or demos that I've given. Most of the time you see a demo of a project that has been done, and people show you the final project and how they went about it, break it down. I'm going to demo a project that I haven't made yet. I'm in the process of developing a workflow and a pipeline with certain goals in mind. So I want to make a little show that's entirely done in Cinema 4D and After Effects. It's these little robots, and I want it to be kind of a realistic look. It's going to be a little comedy show, whatever, but I really, really want to truncate the pipeline as much as possible so that we can go from ideation to creation to rendering to being done in as short a time as possible. So stylistically, let me pull up. This is such a new project for me that I only have like a couple render tests of it, and everything I'm gonna demo is literally just made for this demo because I didn't have enough materials to show you. So the general look, this was my first test of just coming up with like how I should render a realistic look using shot locations. This is just my backyard, a stepping stone in my backyard, and then some 3D elements that I just kind of threw together to just see if I can get some textures to work and look like they live in the scene. It's all shot on my iPhone, and if we switch to here, this is me with my little chrome ball, my garden ball that cost me like about $8, and this is how it's lit with an HDR that I shot on my iPhone, again, with just bracketed exposures. and then combining them in Photoshop and bringing them in. I'm explaining this as kind of a backdrop so you can get an idea of what the look might look like, but I'm not going to delve into the Redshift pipeline that I am going to be doing there. I'll show you one more image that I did not have the foresight to pop up yet. Here we go. Renders, screen caps. I only have one, oh, that's not even the most recent. One version of one of the robots that I'm creating. Just kind of like super simple little guys that I'm gonna just make in Cinema. This one's just made with a lot of MoGraph pieces, but you can kind of see I have this LCD screen, and this little bit of this simple little robot became the most complicated part of how I wanted to work out a fast animation pipeline. The challenges of animating this project are going to be in how I just animate the robots to have personality, to move, to interact with their environment, and then also the effects that go into it. And the challenge with the robot is that they have this LCD face, and that needs to be a texture, most likely. I want it to look polished, I want it to look kind of real, but I couldn't think of a way to actually animate this and render it looking nice in Cinema, because I needed it to look at things, I needed it to react, I needed to see the timing in Cinema to really get a feel, so I wouldn't be doing a render, sending it over to After Effects to finish, placing the texture on the face, and then being like, well, that didn't feel natural. So I'm telling you this ahead of time because we're going to get there, but we're going to take a few steps to get there. How many of y'all are Cinema 4D and After Effects users? Okay, that's pretty dope. Okay, cool. Everyone else is aware of Cinema 4D and After Effects. I know we just had an awesome demo. By the way, that was really cool. And that's going to make me want to open Houdini again and then close it because I'm scared. So, first off, a primer into what Maxon Cineware is. If I open up After Effects, actually, let me start in Cinema. I can create something really simple. I'm just going to make a real simple cube. Look at how pretty that cube is. It's going to tell us, it's going to do the trick though. Now, if I take this cube and I save it out, I'm going to call it cube. If I would have named it sphere, you would have been so puzzled. All right, I'm going to go into After Effects, and I can go into my Cinema folder and drop in cube. And so one of the amazing things about how Cinema and After Effects works together is I don't know any other 3D compositing pairing that can natively take the 3D file and run it as if it's footage. You can export OBJs, FBXs, Alembics, and all that stuff into programs like Nuke or into certain plugins that After Effects has. But I can take this Cinema 4D 3D file that I have just opened and saved just now, drop it into my After Effects timeline, and I have, whoa, and there it goes. Oh, I have a mouse. That's much easier. And I have this right in there. So if I come in here and I give this an animation, let's just give it a spin. Okay, if I play that, I've got a spinning box. Super simple, but it's gonna illustrate the point. I just saved it. I switch back to my After Effects, and I ran preview it, and the animation is coming directly through into After Effects. So this opens up a ton of possibilities. This is not rendered. This is rendering using the Cinema 4D render engine. Well, it has various render engines that are available, software, OpenGL, and then even full renders. And you can put render effects in Cinema 4D, and they will come through and render through into After Effects. So at NAB this year, I did a demo of a opening to a title sequence, Tales from the Tour Bus. I don't know, has anyone seen that show? No, two people, that's cool. So you haven't seen my intro, great. And so I kind of explored during that project how I could update in After Effects and apply textures that I knew that the client needed to change later on and make timing adjustments in Cinema, and it would automatically update in After Effects. But it was a very simple application. I basically had, you can import the camera and the nulls. So if I go into my plugin for my cube, let's actually make a camera real fast. So now I have a camera. If I come back into here, click on my footage, and in the Cineware plugin, I can click extract, and it brings me a camera. So this is the camera from my scene. If I were to put a null onto my cube, and I apply an external compositing tag, hit save, I can come back into here, extract, and now I have a null. And my null is tracking along with my cube. And if I moved my camera, it would do the same thing. So this is really cool and powerful. However, I needed to find a way to make more complex pairings that I could update quickly. And so to that end, I'm going to start by showing you a demo of just how powerful... Oh, I don't have any of my programs or my files open. Sorry. To kind of show you what you can do with a combination of Cinema 4D and After Effects, this is a real simple little object I brought in. It's a, I can't remember. It's a kit bash pick kit that I bought. And I just gave this a spin, much like that cube. And one thing you can do is you can, let me do this. Let me grab this thing. Start from scratch, make a new one. If I drop this in, this doesn't have any animation on it. It's just simply this object. I can take a MoGraph cloner and add a null. And this cloner, if I don't have this on, you can see that, oh, well, maybe it won't see that. Let me drop a cube onto that object. All right. So a cloner is an object in Cinema 4D that replicates other objects. And what you can do is you can do this in different ways. You can do a linear grid like this. It's just three in a row. You can do a radial grid. You can do it as a grid array. And so you can have a whole bunch of them. But you can also have it look at an object. And so if you ever see, like, you know, in the Iron Man movies and all the Marvel stuff, they always have these really cool computer interfaces where they have Tony Stark's Iron Man piece of his kit is spinning around and there's lines coming off of it and all that stuff. So what I can do is I can pull sections off of that object by taking this cloner and having it look at my object. So if I turn this back off, I have these little cubes randomly placed around. And I have control over how those are put on there. I can make it so that it's on the vertexes. I can make it so, oh boy, there's a lot of vertexes on that thing. Let's just say surface, and then I can up the number of them, and it'll loosely trace where that object is. Boop, boop. If I make a more easily seeable thing, you can see that those are all sticking to it kind of randomly. They're just picking random faces and placing a null there and a cube there. But now what I can do is I can, let me reverse the order of this, add one of those external compositing tags. I can take this shape that has all of these randomly selected points, and I can create an object out of it. And so now I have this cloner object is now a bunch of geometry, and it has all these nulls, and it has all these external compositing tags. And if I drop my object onto there, I can do that same thing we did earlier, where I spin this thing around and they stick. So let's just really quickly grab a couple of these. Just give it a little bit of spin. And so we get this kind of like motion, we have all these points, that seems like a really good start for doing some kind of FUI kind of coolness. I already have this built, so I am going to jump into here. And that's the control. So this is straight up that imported C4D project. And what you can do is, if I were to render this, it would look like really dark because it's really, really reflective. You can add effects to it, like cell renderer. If I do that, it'll give me outlines. And I can do a whole bunch of fun stuff like that. I'll probably turn the cubes off if I were to do it, but coming back into After Effects, I already have it set up. So this is just that object. The lines are kind of a whitish blue. And just like with the cube, this thing renders directly into After Effects, like this. And so, how many of you that use After Effects have used expressions before? Okay, cool. So those of you who haven't, expressions are a JavaScript-based language in After Effects that is lets you really easily script, well, relatively easily if you, it's easier than programming. But it's kind of like programming. It's just easier than programming. That lets you connect different layers to different ways and to do math and all that kind of fun stuff. Well, so what I've done is there is a plugin called Saber. And it's a free plugin. It's really neat. Saber is a plugin that lets you create a line between two points or along a mask or whatever you want to do. And it has all sorts of fun effects on it. You can make it look like a lightsaber, which is how it gets the name, laser beam, or whatever. And so I wanted to use it to connect points like they do in those fancy Marvel movies. And something I did was, I'm going to really quickly make a new project. So if I make a new solid, and I draw myself a little, I don't know, little path, doesn't look like much. But if I come down here, and new in After Effects 2018 is this points follow nulls. And what that does is I can take this mask and I can have it automatically follow where these nulls are. So kind of a better example is probably, oh, I just opened a thing. All right. Instead of that one, let's make a really simple diamond. There we go. Fewer points for me to worry about. And so now, without animating the mask, I can grab these points and I can move them around however I want. Super useful if you want a more organic motion on an animated mask, because you can animate the points individually, which gives it a lot more life. So you can also then put Saber on here and change the custom core to layer masks. And now it's following that point, those points. And so I can move around these points, and that works like a charm. So how I use that in here is I set up a series of nulls around the outskirts. They're just 100 and 100, I don't know, whatever, 100. They're 100 pixels away from every corner. And by using expressions, I have added a control layer that has a start index and an end index, because I have a start point and an end point. So this is the start point, the one that connects to these squares. And this is actually a little bit of a complex thing to explain now that I'm looking at it. But if we come back into here, for instance, what I can do is make another null. And if I take this position, let's add an effect. I'm going to add a slider effect. Just going to set it to 1 right now. And so you can see where this null is right now. Now, if I go to this position, tell it to look at this position below it, it's going to tell me that this is, wait a minute, what did I do? I did the wrong thing. Wait a minute, what's that? Oh, okay, sorry. I'm going to have it look below, and it's going to say this comp layer, the name of the layer, and transform position. That's cool. But now, if I change this name from the name of the layer to index plus 1, what it's going to do is this null that we created is looking at the index, which is the identifier of this layer. It's going to look at that one plus one, so the one below it. And now what I get is that as I change the number on this slider, it moves to other nulls. And so that's the basic principle behind being able to control across to different nulls based on certain types of animation. So I have a bunch of nulls all over my object that I created, and it is cycling down and animating through using my control and picking one down as it goes, as it animates. And so this can show the power of how you can create animation through just a couple keyframes that looks a little more complex and can cheat a little bit, and that is the core of everything that's going to follow after this. So, does that make any sense?
Yes.
All right, cool, thank God. All right, moving back to my problem, this is a little robot face that I kitbashed together to demo this concept that I have. So, if we remember that my problem was that I wanted to see all the animation happen in the Cinema 4D so that I could accurately get an idea of timing. And so I just kind of already placed a little bit of animation in here. I've got this little robot face. He's just kind of looking around. He sees the can. He's got a little squinties. His eye kind of twitches. So you'll see below that there is another face. And if I turn off the camera, this is my control face. God, that looks really weird and moiry, doesn't it? So, Cineware is really powerful, but it has a few limitations. In order to transfer the data of position and rotation, scale and stuff like that, it has to be one-to-one. It doesn't bring over parenting. It doesn't bring over being nested into other things. It's the absolute position, and it has to be on something that's animated. It has to be on a null. And this means that my first time trying this, I just animated this face. This is a little temporary face I made. And what happened was I got all the position data and the rotation and scale up here, and it was really difficult to translate into After Effects. But if I come back here, you can see that this is a render in After Effects of the same animation. It's slow, but it's faster than rendering it and importing it. I promise. So I'm seeing the motion. I'm able to work in Cinema and kind of get the gist of the speed of what I want it to be doing. So if I bring the camera back on, and what I was able to do is I took this information and created a face that imitated it, but had effects on it, because I really want this to look nice. So this is just some shape layers and a little bit of a gradient. I've got a chromatic glow on it to give it a little bit of an older feel. And then I've got this Hollow Matrix plugin from Red Giant that kind of gives it like a really old and kind of junky LCD face. You can see it kind of flickering. And this is the look I wanted, and I want it to look like it was like old but slick, you know? It's definitely an LCD. And so what's happening is, all of my animation down here that I'm doing, if I go into my face export, it's all about moving these elements. So the eyebrow can move like this, and I can keyframe it. I have an espresso rig that connects all of those shapes down below to the eyes, to both eyes, to the eyes and the eyebrows, the pupils, and it all controls the way that these all move. So I can move these control interfaces. So you can see if I animate these around, or if I go to iTwitch, I can change the scale, and that's my blinking or my twitching. I get all this animation up here that matches all the movement. And then when I come back into After Effects, it all comes in. And then it's being tracked in and looking at the camera. So here's the thing that is the real crux of the workflow. So you've seen all the little individual parts, but the cool part is this. Everything is looking across from one comp to another, and the face, it has versions of all of these nulls, and these are looking at the nulls that are being brought in by Cineware. But let's just say that I'm not really happy with this movement. Let's just say that towards this end, I want to have this guy back out. So I'm gonna grab this face, this head right here. I'm gonna make a keyframe, and I'm gonna back him away because he is nervous. I'm gonna make him tilt his head that way and back. I'm gonna keyframe. Oh, he's shocked. I'm gonna hit save. And now, when we go to the end, you can see that the face that I created in that other pre-comp fits directly over the face we have. But now when I go to the end of the shot, it doesn't match. And this is the part I'm really proud of. All I have to do is go in and delete my keyframes. All of my expressions become unlinked. But if I go to my Cineware and I re-import them all, because I have them linked outside of the comp, across comps to the main comp, it'll automatically update. And this is the crux of the whole workflow that I really wanted to come together with. So this means that I can do things like, let's just say I want a different camera. Let's make a change to this camera so that when it pulls out here, the camera goes around here like that. And bam, I have moved that camera and it automatically updates and all of my camera tracking comes through with it. And this becomes really cool and really important when I want to add other effects. So for instance, I was thinking, all right, what else can I do to this that would be interesting? I thought maybe what I could do is add some drama and action. Oh, that gave it away. So now he sees this can and he gets angry. And he shoots it. So I just kind of kitbashed a little gun together. I can hit save. I come back into here. And then it's automatically in. But that laser blast is kind of weak, right? It's a visual reference in Cinema 4D, and it's also going to provide me information that comes over. So what I did was, using Saber, I created a laser blast using the 3D data of those nulls. So if I come into this project and I find my barrel and my target, I can see that I brought over scale data along with it. So what I can do is I can pull expression information from that. It feeds into the Saber pre-comp. This allows me to add, what if I turned it on? There we go. It allows me to add that effect directly after seeing it in Cinema 4D. But I think the timing is kind of terrible. So part of what I am really excited about with this is I can go into my dope sheet and I can pick up all my gun keyframes and I can just scoot them on over. Just move them slightly that way. Full disclosure, I've only been using a PC a year. I've used Macs my whole life. All right, and so now, boom, and then he moves away as it blows up. That makes more sense. Maybe the camera move doesn't, but we're gonna save it and take a look anyways. And so now, I'm gonna delete all my stuff, come in here and extract my information. And now when's it happen? It happens 97 frames. Okay, we're gonna get old while this renders. And it's automatically updated to give me kind of a more real-time example and to see how this is gonna look. And so in this way, I feel like just animating the characters in cinema wouldn't give me the whole picture, because I feel that the effects and the characters and the face, it's all part of the storytelling. Like, it's not just seeing a play blast without a face and without an effect. And oftentimes we'll put like ad hocs in, like fake geometry to represent effects, but it's often not really good enough to give you the gravitas or like the concept of it. And I really want this to go fast. I want this to be the kind of thing that one animator could animate and finish in After Effects. And I think this sort of gives you that ability. But anyways, I'm going to cut it short, or long, or however long it was. I have no sense of time. And thank you for paying attention. And I hope this was somewhat interesting. I know it wasn't, you didn't get to see a finished piece. But that's my presentation.
All right, so does anybody have any questions? Got a lot of After Effects people in here, I know that. Question is this a passion project?
Yeah, it's kind of a passion project. I mean, I don't know, if it turns out cool, maybe it'll, I mean, I don't know. We're allowed to pitch stuff, so this would be like a neat project to pitch, but who knows.
Anybody else?
Anybody else? I know there's some good question askers out there. Anybody else? Is most of your work like this?
I mean, you saw my reel, but, well, right now I'm not doing a lot of cinema. As part of the compositing department, I really only use After Effects. But yeah, I mean, I've always used cinema and After Effects together, commercials and music videos and title sequences.
Anybody else?
So one of the challenges with using Cineware is that if you import those things and you link like parent things to them in After Effects, like let's say you just worked in your main comp, then if you had to move a camera or something like that, you'd have to blow away all your layers and then you'd lose all your parenting or whatever. So by putting things into pre-comps, into other pre-comps, pointing to the pre-comp with a static name, so like the camera name would always be the same camera name, then when you delete it, it just goes, oh, I'm broken, and then you bring it back, and it's like, oh, you're still there, or you're back.
So then if you change names, you have to change the expression?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you could, I figured out this crazy roundabout thing where you could pull the name of a layer in After Effects in a comp by pulling the string of a certain index, and it was this weird, I showed it to my boss and he just got angry. It was this weird like feedback loop to like find out how to do it, but it was really complicated. I don't recommend it. It's just easier to just go in and edit the name of the camera. Yeah, I used Max. My job, we only have PCs at Rooster Teeth. And so, I mean, just freelancing. I mean, I wanted to anyways because I wanted to get into, like, Redshift. And I tried for a good year to get Redshift to work on a Mac, on my Mac. And it just was a disastrous experience. But after a year, I kind of know how to use it. And then I'm lost on my Mac now. But I still forget and my fingers get confused and kind of angry.
That's the hardest part, remembering to hit Control instead of Command.
I don't know how to use a Mac anymore. I go right to the PC ones now.
The muscle memory changes.
You shut up.
we're all kind of in that boat where there's like hardware and software things that make us like kind of need to get into PC, even though we really don't want to if we're Mac people. But you got to do what you got to do.
I did it.
Yeah.
Thank you guys. It's because of you guys that I.
Sorry.
Yeah. Sorry about that.
Oh. Yeah.
Anybody else? Is that it? That's it? All right.
Oh, no.
Oh.
How big is your team
there?
Like my team in specific or animation department or? I don't know the numbers. We just doubled our department over the summer. So I think we're at about 150. So my comp department on Ruby has 9. Lighting has 9. And we have another show, Genlock, that's coming out soon. And that's, I don't know if anyone's seen that. We have Michael B. Jordan, Dakota Fanning, Maisie Williams, like, our cast is absolutely insane, and so we're putting a lot of muscle behind that show. It's a big giant mech show. So, you know, also if you're a compositor, you might work on that show if you really want to come work for us.
General turnaround time on compositing.
You're gonna love this.
Okay, so we just had a 140 shot episode that we finished in about 4 days. That includes effects. So like lighting department gets it and they have, you know, like 4 or 5 days. We have about 4 or 5 days. We did a 360 shot episode with over 500 effects just in After Effects effects. And we did that in about 8 days. It's an insane, insane turnaround, especially in After Effects. It's fun though. The show looks really good. We used to make it in Poser.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Ooh.
True story.
Yeah, how's Austin doing? I know a lot of people from California are moving to Austin. Are animators from California moving to Austin too?
Yeah, you know, well, it depends if you are talking about studio animation, like big studio animation versus motion graphics. I would say that motion graphics is a little tougher in Austin. I was working as a creative director at a company for 4.5 years when I first moved there. And it wasn't really big jobs. A lot of the times the local agencies will go to Los Angeles or out of town to get their talent. The studio culture, which is something I'm totally new to. I've only been there a year and it's hugely different. People travel for it. Like they do a show and then they'll be there for a year or two and then they move to another city. So we have people from all over that have come down just to work on Ruby for the season or Genlock. What was the original question? Oh, just like in general. Oh, no. So Austin is surprisingly like big on the anime. We also have another studio in town called Powerhouse, and they make Castlevania for Netflix. So like the two or three big like anime shows made in America are all made in Austin.
Anyone else? All right. All right, well, everybody give Penelope a round of applause.
Thank you very much. This was a lot of fun.
MoGraph.com, an online resource for motion graphic artists. Start your week with the MoGraph podcast. Industry news, interviews with your favorite artists, and terrible humor. Watch live shows and interviews from MoGraph events like NAB, SeaGraph, HalfRes, and local meetups. Our MoGraph talks feature live demos and motivation from artists all around the world.
Sometimes you gotta make stuff that you're not gonna put on your reel, and I'm not here to judge.
What if Rick and Morty show up for the countdown at midnight? That's where I peaked in life, in my career.
We gotta stop this thing, Rick! It's gonna kill us all!
Hear from the people that create your software, design your render engines, and artists that are changing the face of modern motion graphics.
You get that render done. Yeah, you better frame what?
MoGraph tutorials and online classes will teach you about Cinema 4D, After Effects, as well as other popular software and render engines.
Throw in the HDR Studio, take the render settings, pick the HDR, put in a reflection, and gorgeous!
Branch into new software. Learn time-saving tips, techniques, workflows, and lessons that'll keep you up to date in the world of motion design.
Oh, brother, those are some of my favorite elves.
I love projects that scare me. When our art director comes to us and asks for something that I had never done before, man, it gets me pumped.
Join the conversation in our live sessions, check out our plugins, or join the hundreds of daily active users in our Slack channel for technical help, advice, contests, or just to joke around.
Real nice banana.
Yeah, that's so funny. All right. I'm going to live forever.
Subscribe today and get the latest updates on our YouTube and other social media channels.
Take all your dreams and just do it!
We don't care how you get here, folks. Just get here.
Subscribe to MoGraph.com.